a passage to India takes place. Okay. So the British Raj, the name of this empire, lasted from 1858 to 1947. So like we saw in the earlier slide, the novel that we are dealing with today is A Passage to India by E.M. Foster. As the title itself indicates, this is about a passage to India. This is where we are traveling to India. Like the last novel that we studied, you know, Jim Conrad's novel, we were in the heart of Africa, right? Then we went on to Ireland. We were with James Joyce, and now we are with E.M. Foster in India. And we are talking about an India when the British Raj existed here, okay? Just before the World War I. Okay, so the British Raj in India, if you talk about it, lasted from around 1858 to 1947 when we got our independence. The subcontinent was divided into several states. Some of them were allowed to be governed by an Indian ruler. But Parliament and the British royalty maintained power over many provinces and the Raj as a whole. So though the subcontinent was divided into several states, okay, and some of them, you know, Indian rulers were ruling over it also. But overall, you know, British royalty maintained power over many provinces and also the entire British Raj as a whole. The British influenced and ultimately controlled India's politics and economics and introduced Western technology and culture. So this is what the British did here, right? Foster's novel examines the many tensions between British expatriates and the Indians who had to live under a foreign oppressor that saw itself as being there for India's own good. So we have already looked at, you know, in the earlier novels that we discussed, we have already seen how Kipling talked about the white man's burden. So in a way, we deal with that topic again here. See, Foster's novel is examining the many tensions between British expatriates and the Indians. So the people who come here, the English men who travel to India and come here, and how they interact with the Indians here. The Indians living here belong to this land, yet they are not powerful in their own land, right? They're living under the oppressors, the foreign oppressors. And these foreign oppressors saw themselves as being sort of saviors of the land. They thought that they were coming here to rescue or civilize the natives. So that itself is problematic, right? Now, the questions raised by the book, one of the first questions raised by the book is that, why are the colonized never granted the status of their own human individuality? So the colonizers come here saying that, you know, it is their duty to civilize and humanize the natives. But then we never hear the voice of the colonized people. So why is it that, you know, in all these narratives, the colonized person never gets a human individuality? Now, they are described as wild beasts who are either demonic or immature. They are not seen as adults capable of deciding their own political and cultural destinies. So this is the way in which the colonized people are portrayed. Next. Why is only one value system that is cherished by the Caucasian seen as possessing cultural superiority? So it is a European standpoint that is thrust upon as being the one and only. Okay, so why is it like that? Okay, the only value system that seems to be upheld and that seems to be seen as perfect in the eyes of these people are those of the Caucasians or the European empire building scheme altogether. So why is empire building entirely perceived as being a male activity? Another section of the community that gets silenced and that gets totally voiceless is that of the women. The entire, you know, empire building activity is seen as very male oriented. So the voice of women are totally suppressed in this endeavor altogether. Now, finally, why is it that when those who carry the white man's burden are said to have gained moral high ground, no mention is made of the political and economic gains that accrue to them? So they say that they come here to civilize us, like they're doing us a favor. But then they make it out like they're doing a lot of sacrifice. They are giving up so much to come and civilize the natives here, the ignorant natives here. Yet, what is often left out from the narrative is all the economic gain that the white man gets when he comes to these colonies and completely suppresses the people there and takes over the whole land for their own economic profits. So that is something that remains left out of the narrative. So these are the questions that are raised by the book. And in the image there, you can see this was Okay, someone has unmuted their microphone. Could you please mute it? Do check your microphones muted, because if your microphones are switched on, the voice will interfere, the sound from that will interfere, and my voice will not be heard. So the others listening to the class will not be able to hear. Okay, do check your microphone, see that it's muted. All right then. But when I ask questions, please unmute it, give me the answers also, okay? All right then, let's go on. So you can see the picture there on the screen of see how all these powers, you know, there are three individuals there holding sacks, and one is Germany, one is Britain. So we know all of these European countries were almost like, you know, grabbing places from the map, you know, taking over the entire globe with this whole agenda of colonization. So that's what this is. Now, I want to draw your attention to this poem by Walt Whitman. So the title of this poem is Passage to India. So I'm going to read that, okay? Lo, soul, seest thou God's purpose from the first? The earth to be spanned, connected by network, the race of neighbors to marry and be given in marriage, oceans to be crossed, the distant brought near, lands to be welded together. Then not your deeds only, O voyagers, scientists and inventors shall be justified. All these hearts, as of fretted children, shall be soothed. All affections shall be fully responded to. The secret shall be told. All these separations and gaps shall be taken up and hooked and linked together. The whole earth, this cold and passive, voiceless earth, shall be completely justified. Nature and man shall be disjoined and diffused no more. The true son of God shall absolutely fuse them. O pensive soul of mine, O thirst unsatisfied, waitest not there, waitest not happily for us somewhere there, the comrade perfect. This is one of the, you know, a part of a poem written by American poet Walt Whitman, where he talks about journeying to India. So Whitman's poem generally, you know, is about exploring his own personality, exploring his spirit. So here he makes this poem about a journey to India something like a metaphor where the soul is journeying into itself. And that's what he's talking about. See, he says that God's purpose right from the first is that the earth should be connected with each and every person, each and every place. And this was the time, you know, when the Suez Canal was built, and in America, the Transatlantic Railroad was built, linking the east to the west of the intercontinental or transcontinental railway was built. So in a lot of ways, you know, the world was getting linked. The telegraph system was put into you know, action. So in all these ways, the world was actually getting more and more connected. And that's what he's saying in the second stanza. See, voyagers, scientists, and inventors, you know, he's actually addressing them. When you attach the word O there, he's addressing them. He's like talking to them. So your actions will be, you know, justified. Your actions shall be noted and commended. And all of the world will be linked together. And then it will be like, you know, you will find the true comrade perfect, the perfect companion. Walt Whitman, often thought of the role of a poet as someone who was like a prophet, okay, a poet prophet connection he often found. So possibly that's what he meant, okay, finding the comrade perfect, the perfect companion. Maybe it was as a companion to his soul, maybe it was as a friend. It's not mentioned clearly, but he said that, after having connected the world, there will be no disjointment between different parts of the world, different kinds of people. All of those will be truly connected, and then you might hope to find the comrade perfect, the perfect companion. So this is the poem written by Walt Whitman, the American poet, and he begins it with a passage to India. He begins it with the words, passage to India. The A is not there. Okay, note that. Huh? Now let me go further and talk to you more about it. Now, based on Kipling's poem, the generations of Englishmen who served their country while stationed in India, no doubt they were believed to have shouldered the white man's burden. I don't think I need to explain the white man's burden again, right? You already know that. A passage to India is fraught with a sense of misery, contingent on the exile from the known, the familiar, and the loved world that it entails. So for the white man, for the Englishman coming to a place like India, so strange and completely different from the kind of world that they're used to, it includes a sense of misery, which is part and parcel of being exiled from their own land, what they know and what they're familiar with, and the world that they love. This is very different. So for them, it's quite a displacement, you can say. But added to that, along with that, side by side, there is also the sense that socially and economically challenged might find love and comfort more easily in the subcontinent. Those who were not doing well in their own countries, they could probably do well in the Indian subcontinent. So that idea went along with this. So along with this feeling of being exiled from their own land was also the feeling that those who were not feeling very, very happy or settled in their own countries like England, they could feel and do better for themselves in the subcontinent, in the Indian subcontinent. So that was the idea there. And now talking about the title here. The title comes from Walt Whitman's poem, Passage to India, a part of Leaves of Grass. So that is actually the name of the poem, the name of the collection written by Walt Whitman, Leaves of Grass. Okay. So although the writing seems to exalt India, and to exult in India, it raises questions, okay? So these are the questions that come to our mind when we read that poem. First, it offers an essentialist reading, as if India has no right to any existence or reality of its own, and exists only as a territory to be colonized and governed by the poet's imagination. So when the poet writes about traveling to India and connecting it, and it's written from a white man's perspective, as if the country that is being discovered, that is being governed, does not have any perspective of its own. So that becomes kind of an essentialist reading, very almost like a very limited point of view there. Next, India is shown not to be peopled by its own citizens with their own aspirations, but by an amalgam of abstractions, races, voyagers, scientists, and achievers. These are the people that he's addressing by saying, oh, voyagers, or scientists, etc. So we feel that, India and the people who are native to India are not addressed. Who he is addressing is an amalgamation, is like, a joining together of several abstractions. Of races and voyagers and scientists and achievers. No attempt is made to talk about India's multicultural society. So there again, you see there is a limited point of view that's happening there. Then it talks about union between all people, life forms, divine forms, but this seems like triumphalism. This sense of having won over everything that they perceive. So that is also like having won a battle or something, you know, like having won over everything that they see. So when the poet talks about union between different kinds of people and life forms and divine forms, etc., it does not have anything to do with India's reality. This also makes us feel like this is the white man who is talking about winning over everything that he wants to possess. Okay, so that sense of triumphalism comes into the way in which India and the people of India are portrayed in this, or rather not portrayed in this poem. Finally, when we read this, we do wonder who is this comrade perfect in the poem. So these are the questions that this poem raises, but it's from this poem that Foster has taken the title A Passage to India. So what is the difference here? When we read this poem, we saw that, see, it began with this word there, Passage to India. But when Foster writes it, he puts an A there, A Passage to India, right? Now, what is the significance of that? We will just see that in a moment. Look at the picture given there. It's like one of the first ships to travel to Mumbai. This is, you know, ships traveling from European countries and docking in Mumbai. So you can see how it was the dock in Mumbai sometime in the 1800s. Now, so Foster's adaptation. Okay, so Foster wrote his novel based on the title of Walt Whitman's poem, and he has adapted it. He's changed it a little bit. So Foster slipped in the indefinite article before Whitman's phrase, so that it now reads A Passage to India. So see that? It's A Passage to India. What does that signify there? Tentativeness takes the place of certainty. When you say A Passage to India, that means there are other passages also, right? This is one of the passages, A Passage to India. So tentativeness, you know, like it's not absolute. So there is a sense of, you know, there could be other passages also. So tentativeness takes the place of certainty. A passage suggests there may be many more passages than the one taken by the writer. Now, Foster's title is a more self-examining and self-critical one applicable to modernism. So when it is something that, you know, doesn't say that it's an absolute, you know, thought, when it is self-critical and self-reflexive, kind of self-examining, then we can say it actually is part of this whole movement of modernism, right? When there is this sense of self-questioning that happens, self-searching that happens. So in that sense, we can say the novel gets, you know, some of the features that we can apply to modern novels. Now, an open-ended journey that doesn't proclaim its primacy. So this journey, titled A Passage to India, is a journey that is an open-ended journey. So it doesn't have a definitive end. It's an open-ended journey, and that doesn't say that this is the only journey, this is the only passage to India. It doesn't say that. It doesn't talk about its primacy, that it's the only one. It doesn't talk like that. Okay, so this is how Foster has adapted from the poem Passage to India by Walt Whitman. Now, going on to the next point. So, both writers wrote during the aftermath of wars that revolutionized their societies. Walt Whitman wrote after the American Civil War that ultimately brought the industrialized North and the agrarian South together in the federation that we know today as the United States of America. I'm sure you're familiar with the history of America, right? there was this whole divide between the North of America and the South of America, right? As to the question of slavery, right? Basically, it's slavery, right? Because the cotton plantations, which was mostly, you know, the workers there were the slaves, and that was what fed into the industrialized part of America in the North. And that's where this divide started, and which led to the Civil War and led to the declaration or the formation of the United States of America. So both of these writers, whether it is Walt Whitman or whether it's E.M. Forster, they wrote during the aftermath of wars. Aftermath means just after a period of civil unrest, just after a period of having gone through or lived through terrible wars. So as far as Whitman was concerned, it was the American Civil War. And for Forster, he began writing A Passage to India before the First World War and before its publication, witnessed both the formation and the emasculation of the League of Nations, the declarer of the British Empire after the war, and the rise of God. So Forster had also lived through a lot of activity. He had lived through, I mean, he started writing this before the First World War, and he lived through the First World War, and before its publication in 1924, he witnessed the formation of the League of Nations and also the loss of the power of League of Nations. The British Empire declined after the World War, and then the rise of Gandhi. These were the political happenings that Forster had also lived through. So in that sense, we can say both Whitman and Forster had lived through a lot of important political changes. Then, so earlier passages to India. Now, I told you that this is not the only passage to India, right? That's why he puts this, indefinite article there, A. Right, a passage to India. Now, what were the earlier passages to India? Babur, the first invader of India, whom Forster discusses at any length, is Babur, okay, the founder of the Mughal dynasty. So, the first invader of India that Forster discusses is Babur, the Mughal invader. First, he shares a criticism of India they make using Babur's own words. Next, he goes on to show that Babur developed beyond this point and that he values Babur's later position. Babur's later position of appreciation, he sympathizes with the colonized. Okay, so when we talk about earlier passages to India, Forster mentions Babur, okay? First, he shares the criticism that, Babur doesn't take to India, okay? And he criticizes India. But then, like any other invader, he does not understand India. He doesn't take to India. But later, he tries to understand what is India. And he goes on to show that, Babur did not stop with not comprehending what is India and went on to understand what is India. And he values Babur's later positions of appreciation and the sympathies with the colonized. So as a Mughal invader, he was not an invader in that sense. He did learn to appreciate the country that he invaded and did learn to appreciate the mind and sympathized with the people who were colonized. So going on, the East India Company. Now we're talking about different passages to India. Now the other, company that actually took over the rule of India was the East India Company. Now, he thinks of the British as hypocrites, the island of hypocrites, the people who have built up an empire with a Bible in one hand, a pistol in the other, and financial concessions in both pockets. Look at that. This is the way in which he's describing the British. So, island of hypocrites. It's an island country, right? So, island of hypocrites, the people who built an empire with Bible in one hand, a pistol in the other hand, and financial concessions in both pockets. So, what did they do? Basically, what is he saying? They use force and they use religion in order to make money for themselves. So, commercial aggrandizement based on force characterized the establishment of the East India Company. Company established factories at Surat in 1612, Madras in 1639, Bombay 1661, and Calcutta in 1690. So this is what was on the agenda of this company, right? A commercial aggrandizement, making themselves, grander and grander, aggrandizement. Commercial aggrandizement and how did they achieve it? Using force, using religion, using the power of the gun. Okay, so this is how they achieved it. And they soon established factories in all the major cities in India. Surat had a flourishing textile industry, which was completely put down by the invading British. So Surat, Madras, Bombay, Calcutta, and all these places, they set up the East India Company. Now, government by the crown. The civil service, which administers India on behalf of the crown, ignores the daily realities of Indian life and is therefore ignorant of the realities of the Indian spirit. Now, Foster's attitude before his first visit, first passage to India. See? As an individual, his feeling for India was colored by two of his friends. Okay, first friend was Syed Ross Massoud, whom he had tutored briefly. So he had taught Syed Ross Massoud. Okay, two people were the ones who actually led him to India. Whose His attitude to India was colored by two of his friends. One he had taught. His name was Syed Ross Massoud. And the other one was a college mate, okay, who had gone into the Indian civil service. His name was Malcolm Darling. So these two people were the ones who actually drew Foster to India. Now, significance of India to him rests on the basis of personal friendship. So in that sense, he's different from the usual member of the British Raj who comes to India. Right? So he stands aside from the empire because he didn't come here to govern and he didn't come here to make money. So from the commercial standpoint, and he didn't come here to improve people from the religious and the evangelist point of view. So this empowers him to be more critical. So it was personal relationships which brought him to India. And as such, he differentiates himself, his standpoint from the eye of the colonizer. As a novelist, Massoud was the first person to urge Foster to write a novel on India. He believed in Foster's ability to sympathetically feel for a situation, even while analyzing. So, to empathize, the writer's ability to feel for a situation, even while he was able to stand objectively and analyze it. So, this is how Foster is different from any other colonist who comes with the intention of invading, looting, plundering. Now, let's go to the next one. Representation of India, approaches to the novel. Okay, so some of the different approaches to the novel. The writing in A Passage to India is the expression of particular kind of reality, historical, literary, or philosophical. The kinds of writing in the text. Okay, you find different kinds of writing in the text. One is that of a travel guide. So it's written like a travel guide. Okay, let's read a little bit from the excerpt and then we'll discuss what it is. So see, except for the Malabar Caves, okay, that is a place that is mentioned in the novel. Except for the Malabar Caves, and they are 20 miles off. The city of Chandrapur presents nothing extraordinary. Edged rather than washed by the river Ganges, it trails for a couple of miles along the bank, scarcely distinguishable from the rubbish deposit so freely. The streets are mean, the temples ineffective, and though a few fine houses exist, they are hidden away in gardens or down alleys whose filth deters all but the invited guests. the very wood seems made of mud, the inhabitants of mud moving. This is a description, you know, the location in the novel is Chandrapur. And Foster says that it's an insignificant town. There is hardly anything of interest in this town. So, very contrary to what a travel guide might tell you, right? I mean, just open TripAdvisor or something like that. Every place that you check for, you know, they will write places of interest and try to make that place look, you know, like a place that you should definitely visit. But here, when you read, do you feel get that feeling? It's almost like an insignificant place where everything is very desolate and, you know, there's nothing except dirt and, you know, garbage everywhere. And then the very wood of the houses seem to be made of mud. What's more, even the people seem to be like mud moving, you know, made of mud and just moving. This is the way in which he's presenting Chandrapur, the place where this novel is set. And the only thing, you know, that this mentioned is Marabar Caves, the, you know, they're near the city of Chandrapur, 20 miles away from the city of Chandrapur is this Marabar Caves. And there is nothing extraordinary other than that. So this is how he presents Chandrapur, describes Chandrapur to the readers. Now, what is the consequence of this? Let's analyze that. First, it seems designed to help a reader place a town in her mind by suggesting its importance on account of any natural, historical, or architectural features it may possess. Conversely, as in this case, it helps the reader rate such a town as being of no significance. So a typical travel guide would try to place a city or a town as being a place of interest and point out must-visit spots in that town or city. Here, it is the opposite that's happening, right? Conversely, in this case, it's helping the reader to rate such a town as being of no significance at all. Next, the account seems designed to help a reader find a way around such a river. Such a town, sorry. So in a travel guide, you will find, helpful hints as to how to get about a particular town, right? Which bus you can take, which train you can take, such details. So in a travel account, generally, you know, it's written in such a way as to help the reader to find their way around a town. A river, street, building, etc. are placed against each other so that the ugliness which marks one feature automatically touches the next. So usually in a normal travel guide, you will find details about streets and buildings, etc. But in this case, what you find is that these geographical details and specialties are marked off, but rather than talking about the special features, this is actually marked out by the ugliness that you see there. Okay, the ugliness which marks one feature actually spreads over to the next feature also, adding to the insignificance of the town. So this is the way in which that place is brought before us. Finally, the account seeks to transfer the meanness of the town to its residents. Okay, so the meanness of the town is transferred to the residents. The town is so insignificant, and out of, you know, that insignificant, even the people who live there are presented as being of no consequence. The very wood seems made of mud and the inhabitants of mud moving. Look at that. So even the inhabitants are reduced to just clumps of mud moving. The dismissal seems complete as people and places seem consigned to dustbin where they belong. So this is the way in which Chandrapur is presented by the writer, just as a dirt heap. In A Passage to India, Foster parodies the travel guide by adopting its style while subverting the application of its contents. So this is what he is doing, you know? Just turning it upside down, subverting the whole concept of what a travel guide should do, right? Totally turning it upside down. Foster has already demolished the spirit behind the travel guide by insisting not on well-known sites of Chandrapur, but on the less well-known feature, the Malabar Caves. So he's presenting to us a picture of India, which is not the typical kind of picture that you would see in glossy travel guides. And he makes sure to topple all the expectations that we have. And that is why he talks about the town of Chandrapur, an insignificant town. He talks about its drabness. He talks about how dirty it is. He talks about the mud and the filth that is lined on the sides of the river. And the only place of interest that he talks about is also quite an insignificant place, the Marabar Caves, which is like 20 miles away from the city. Okay. The history textbook, okay? So the travel guide organizes details spatially, right? When you a travel guide does this, you know, it gives us spatial details, right? How far is this from one place? How much time it will take to travel, etc. The history book organizes details temporally. Temporally means in terms of time, like 200 years ago or 18th century, etc. So this is one of the differences, right? When it's a travel book, it gives us details of time taken to commute, etc. And also gives us details about space, from, you know, distance from one point to the other, etc. But in a history book, you get details of time. You get details of how old a particular thing is. So Foster mentions the Mauryan Empire. Mauryan Empire thus decentering the British notion of itself as unique. So this is what he does when he presents a historical aspect. He talks about the Mauryan Empire. And that itself is a way in which he decentralizes the fact that the British think that they are the only conquerors who have ever been to India. It brings in the point that British imperialism is just one phase and it will be run over too like the other powers. Whether it is a Mughal, whether it is a Mauryan, all of those imperialistic powers have come, invaded India, and have passed also. Those phases have passed also. So when he brings in the Mauryan Empire, he's actually trying to tell that the British Empire is also only like that. It's not something that is going to be permanent. It will also run its course and its power will also run off. And its power will actually dry up. Then Foster shows both imperialisms have been anti-people. Common people have always known life as ugly and mean, whether ruled by the Mauryans or the British, right? Just like the political parties now, right? Whichever political party is ruling, the common man is still suffering, right? So both imperialisms have been anti-people. Common man, whether it is Mauryans, whether it is the British, have always been suffering, right? From that time to this time, they are still suffering. Then Foster's historical mode debunks British claim to uniqueness and points out how all imperialisms are basically anti-democratic. So the historical mode in A Passage to India debunks, you know, completely discredits this British claim to uniqueness. So Britain cannot have this unique claim to be the one imperialistic power having its control over India. And it also points out, you know, how all imperialisms are basically anti-democratic. They do not take into consideration the wants of the people. They are not based on justice or equality. Now, the next one. The next one is a romantic landscape. Okay, are you able to see the full titles?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, all right. So the sky settles everything, not only climates and seasons, but when the earth shall be beautiful by herself, she can do little, only feeble outbursts of flowers. But when the sky chooses, glory can rain into Chandrapur bazaars, or a benediction pass from horizon to horizon. what changes the ugliness of Chandrapur? You know, so this is a quotation from A Passage to India. Now, the sky settles everything, not only climates and seasons, but when the earth shall be beautiful. By herself, she can do little. The earth by itself cannot do much. That's what is said. The sky settles everything. Only feeble outbursts of flowers. That's what earth does, right? When it's spring, flowers bloom. So that is what the earth does. But the sky, you know, the sky can rain glory into Chandrapur bazaars, or a benediction pass from horizon to horizon. It's like a blessing. A transformation has taken place when it rains. So on the one hand, the human world has always been characterized by alienation. Whether it is race-based or class-based, this alienation has led to ugliness and meanness. On the other hand, the world of nature bestows a blessing over the human world through its beauty. The non-human world sets away all distinctions of class and race generated by the human world, as the sky, the sun, and the rain are shared alike by all humanity. So mankind may create distinctions, mankind may create different races and classes and all of these differences, right, of putting one person against the other, but nature is something that can undo all of these distinctions created by mankind. Because nature, when it chooses, when a flower chooses to bloom, when the sky chooses to shine, or when it chooses to rain, right? The sun and the rain and the sky are all things that are shared by all humans alike, irrespective of class or creed or religion or gender or whatever, right? So that is what is brought out here. The non-human world is thus brought into the novel to redress the imbalances and discriminations created by the human world. So whatever imbalances that you find in the human world is kind of balanced out by the non-human world. So romanticism critiques imperialism. In this way, we can say that romanticism is actually critiquing imperialism, you know, setting a tone of equality in its own way. Yet, no attempt is made to consider specificities, okay, social, political, or cultural of the Indian citizen, of the Indian situation. So is romanticism glossing over the guilt of imperialism? So we can have this romantic viewpoint of nature covering over all inadequacies, nature covering over all dirtiness and all inequalities, all of these things. Nature is able to overcome all of these things. We can say that it's a very romantic viewpoint of imperialism and what imperialism is doing in this country. So when we talk about nature doing that, you know, this question also does come into the reader's mind, right? Is romanticism glossing over the guilt of imperialism, right? Then going to the next one. As a social comedy, okay? So how do we look at this as a social comedy? A Passage to India also works on the level of a social comedy, and the comic mode functions as a useful corrective to the cosmic mode, okay? So sometimes the social comedy that you see is something that brings in a sense of correction, in a corrective mode to the cosmic mode. Now, the description of the civil station, okay? Mostly, you know, place where all the Europeans hang out. The toddy palms, the neem trees, the mangoes, the people that were hidden behind the bazaars now become visible and in their turn hide the bazaars. They glorify the city to the English people. So when the Englishman first comes, he is taken to the civil station. And from the civil station, it's a very beautiful view. You know, you can see toddy palms and neem trees and mangoes and people and all of these things you can see. And it presents a beautiful picture. The bazaars are hidden from there. They glorify the city to the English people. so that the newcomers cannot believe it to be as meager, believe it to be as meager as it is described, and have to be driven down to acquire disillusionment. So they, when they come, when they are taken to the civil station, they see beauty all around. They see nature all around, and they feel that this is beautiful, and they don't believe that Chandrapur is a dirty, insignificant old town. They have to be driven down to the bazaars, they have to be driven down to the main streets to become disillusioned. So for the truth to strike them and for their illusions to be shattered, for disillusionment to come, they have to be taken to the main streets, they have to be taken into the city to really understand how meager it is. So to understand that it's true, what has been described is true. The reader is told that even if the trees look beautiful, the newcomer is warned to expect a meager town. Exotic pretensions of the description are punctured by the line about the disenchantment people feel when they are made to confront the ugly realities behind the leafy screen of the trees. So the reality is there, but it exists beyond the leafy trees that are presented to them. And although they find it hard to believe that this town is meager, you know, when they first arrive, the Englishman finds it hard to believe that this town is meager or insufficient or insignificant. It soon becomes obvious to them when they go to the other side, you know, beyond the trees. When they go, they see the reality. So social comedy, it's almost funny in that sense, right? Social comedy thus punctures the easy romanticism. So if the romantic aspect was describing how nature, the beauty of nature, the beauty of sunshine and rain can overcome the drabness of the city, the poverty of the city, here the social comedy also seems to be puncturing into what was suggested by the romantic view that we read about earlier. Now, what is the modernist perspective? Okay, the modernist quest. So what is a modernist quest? Now, the Malabar Caves, the very first sentence announces their extraordinary nature, and the conclusion circles back to a reminder of the fists and fingers that are the Malabar Hills, containing the extraordinary caves. So the modernist quest talks about how Malabar Caves is seen as, you know, something which is extraordinary. And we are reminded, even in the description of the Malabar Caves, you know, it's described like this, fists and fingers. You know, when you look at the caves from a distance, it's almost like a big rock, like fists and fingers. That is what you could say the Malabar Hills is. And it has these extraordinary caves in it. Now, the caves are used here to suggest a disturbance in an unquestioning acceptance of the universe. They defy all rational attempts to classify them. To this extent, they may perhaps symbolize a quest for meaning in the modernist way. So the caves can be seen here, you know, to suggest something of a disturbance, you know, where when you accept the universe unquestioningly, this is what makes us, you know, stop and think about our point of view. They defy all rational attempts to classify them. Okay, so the caves have not been classified because they are beyond any rational attempt to classify. To this extent, they may perhaps symbolize a quest for meaning in the modernist way. So something that, you know, the meaning of which we cannot explain, right? That it's baffling to us. It's something that is perplexing to us. So in that sense, we can say the caves that have not been actually explained or categorized or classified, they are beyond classification. In that sense, we can say that they are quite modernist. You know? So it's a symbol of something that is undefinable. So something that cannot be known and classified from A to Z. So that in that way, we can say the, you know, the caves are a symbol of the modernist quest of life, which itself, you know, which cannot be completely understood and defined. So that is about the caves there. Now, the next slide. Kinds of writing about the text. So studies in symbolism. The text works chiefly on the level of symbolic statement more than most novels. It has to be absorbed and contemplated, meditated upon like a mandala before it yields its secrets. So I don't know whether you've heard of this word mandala. You can see the picture there of a Buddhist monk drawing a mandala on the ground there, on a surface there. So it's usually drawn in circles, and it seems to, you know, it has a center, okay? And it's something that signifies life, okay? And it has, you know, you have to understand a mandala and know what each symbol stands for. You know, only then will you understand the symbolism that it has. Now, the symbols, just like that, just like a mandala, you know, the symbols of this novel convey universal truths about human psychology and experience. The caves represent the unconscious in two sense. So the caves we just mentioned, Marabar caves, which cannot be classified as, and as such can represent life itself, which cannot be fully understood and defined from the beginning to the end, right? Now, it can also be something that's like a representation of the unconscious, you know, what is there in the unconscious part of our mental makeup, the repressed elements in the individual life and the survivals in modern man of the prehistoric and the pre-human. Those elements that Freud termed the id. It is the unrepressed part of the human psyche, you know. The human psyche, Freud described as id, ego, and superego. It is that, you know, like when a child is, you know, newly born, just few days and months old, right? The child doesn't know anything, right? The child does exactly as it pleases. It could go run and put its fingers in fire, whatever, right? It does not know that this is what is expected of it. But as it grows older, it learns to understand, okay, this is what is expected of me, and develops his own ego, right? It's a sense of, you know, what is there, what should be done, what should not be done. That is when the superego, this sense of what is right and what is wrong comes in. But it is that unrepressed part of the self. So the caves can represent the unconscious, you know, in two senses. The repressed elements in the individual life and the survivals in the modern man of the prehistoric and pre-human. Those elements that Freud termed the id also, you know, so that, you know, the echo from the caves is something before language and before morality. So when they travel, when these people go into the caves to explore, they hear an echo. And that echo can be seen as a symbol of the unconscious, you know, of the unconscious, of something that can be said to be symbolic of something that existed beyond or before language came into being. We could start expressing ourselves only when language was formed, right? But what existed beyond, before language? So that is what you can say is like, you know, the sound, the echo that these people hear when they go into Marabar caves. The symbolic method represents India as more exotic than it is. The symbolic approach uncovers universal psychological truths but distorts the political and cultural realities of India. So when you approach it, you know, from the psychological or the symbolic perspective alone, we do understand the, you know, universal truths lying within the story. You do understand the psychological truths lying within the story, but then it doesn't represent to us, you know, a very exact political or cultural reality of this country. So So that's about the symbolic viewpoint there. Now, studies in language. When you talk about the language here, you know, there is a frequent use of the word nothing in A Passage to India. So the what is it about? See, the frequent use of the word nothing in A Passage to India, therefore, supports general argument that negation has ideological significance. Foster's work presages the end of empire, not simply of the Raj in India, though it does that also, but also the end of the struggle for dominion, which is implicit in the struggle for language and meaning, the struggle to keep man at the center of the universe. So this frequent use of the word nothing seems to have this significance that, you know, he is talking about the end of the empire, not only the end of the British Raj in India, but also, you know, this struggle to keep man at the center of the universe, that's not going to last long. Yeah. Going on, colonial discourse analysis. So models of colonial discourse focuses on questions of race and class and gender at the moment of production of a text and also at its moment of reception. So when you talk about colonial discourse analysis, we are actually talking about how is race presented, how is class and gender presented at the moment of production of a text, and also how is it taken at the moment of its reception. That is colonial discourse analysis. Now, history and A Passage to India. So various dramatic changes took place in history between 1912, that is the year of Foster's first trip to India, and 1960, the year of his last recorded comment of political significance on the novel. How did these changes in history shape the theme of the novel? The novel was begun in Foster. Begun by Foster in his 1912-1913 visit to India, the outbreak of the First World War, which happened between 1914 and 1918, made Foster put it aside. So he began it on his first visit, which was between 12 and 13, and then 14 to 18 was the First World War, so he put it aside. He came to India for the second time in 21 to 22, and he brought the draft of his incomplete novel with him, and finally he completed it and he published it in 1924. So look at it, basically you can say he was writing from 1912-13 to 24. A Passage to India is thus a curious palimpsest of various layers of fact and fiction about the rapidly changing historical phase of India. Palimpsest means one piece of writing over which another later piece of writing has been superimposed. It's like, you know, one layer of writing is being superimposed with another layer of writing added over it. So what happens is that Passage to India has seen so many layers of fact and fiction and so many changes happening in historical India. As far as history is concerned in India, this period from when he began writing to the point that he published it, I've seen a lot of changes happening. And Foster has mixed both fact and fiction into his novel. He wrote to a friend. Okay, now I'm quoting from Foster's letter, one of his letters to a friend. "You asked me about my work. I'm dried up. Not in my emotions, but in their expression. I cannot write at all. I see beauty going by and have nothing to catch it in. I want something beyond the field of action and behavior, the waters of the river that rises from the middle of earth to join the Ganges and the Jamuna, where they join. India is full of such wonders." So this is part of something that he writes to a friend. He has a writer's block, you can say, you know, "I'm dried up, not in my emotions, but in their expression." So he says, I do have emotions, but I do not have the vehicle to express them. I'm not able to write. So I see beauty going by, but then I don't have anything to catch it in. I'm not able to express myself. That's what he's saying. And I want something beyond the field of action and behavior. He wants to sense what is India beyond the sense of action, beyond the peripheral sense that he sees in the life around him, you know, when he's in India. He wants to go deeper into that. Almost like, you know, finding the water of the river that rises from the middle of the earth to join the Ganges and Jamuna. That is River Saraswati, right? River Saraswati is believed to be rising from the middle of the earth to join River Ganges and River Jamuna. So he wants to grasp what is the soul of India, not just record the actions happening around. Now let's analyze about what he has written. See, first, his use of the Saraswati, the invisible river that rises from the middle of the earth, indicates Foster's desire to somehow capture a metaphysical rather than a historical theme for his novel. So he wants to have, India is the location in which he has chosen to write the novel, right? But he doesn't want to have the novel just based historically in India. He wants to go deeper than that. He wants to understand almost like the soul of India on a more metaphysical level. That's why he is referring to Saraswati, or rather the river which is the source of, you know, which rises up from the middle of the earth to go and join Ganges and Jamuna. So that's why he is talking about that. Okay. So his desire to capture something which is more than the mere historical theme of the novels, to go deeper into the metaphysical, or rather the soul of what is really India. Next, it suggests Foster's wish to extend the frontiers of the novel as an art form. Then it offers an idea as to the importance of India for Foster. So that quotation, you know, this is what we understand. And finally, the letter demonstrates Foster's desperate need for something that would ease his inability to write and dried up. You know, with that he means that he has his writer's block, he's not able to write. And his belief that India is what he needs to help him deal with this problem. So we understand these things from his letter to his friend. Then going on, 1912, 1913, in fact, and in fiction, we're going to place these two together and find out what was happening. Okay. So in fact, in reality, okay, this was a time when Morley-Minto reforms were put into action. It culminated in the Indian Council's Act of 1909. And this was something that, you know, Indians were looking forward to, this reforms, seeing it as, you know, one of the early early steps to Swaraj, or self-rule, okay, self-government. But then it did not happen. So their expectations were actually dashed to the ground with this reform, Minto or Morley, or Morley-Minto reforms, okay. See, greater representation was given to Indians. So this is what the reform was about. Okay, greater representation was given to Indians in the provincial councils, but Britain was very keen to avoid any suggestion of parliamentary franchise. So it was not what the Indians were expecting. So in provincial councils, more representation was given to Indians, but still, you know, as far as parliamentary level was concerned, it still was not given any powers. So Morley-Minto reforms actually failed to live up to the expectations of the Indians. Now in fiction, what was happening? Okay, so Foster's first visit appears vaguely evocative of a golden age before politics blighted personal relationships. We read earlier why Foster came to India, right? It was not as a colonizer. He came because of his personal relationships. So the first visit, you can say, you know, was something that that's similar to like kind of a golden age before politics completely changed and destroyed personal relationships. See the little bit, an excerpt from the novel is given here. Hamidullah was glad that Aziz is one of the central characters in the novel. Aziz, whom he loved, took no interest in politics, which ruined the character and career. Yet nothing can be achieved without them. He thought of Cambridge sadly as if another poem that had ended. Politics had not mattered there. Games, work, pleasant society had interwoven and appeared to be sufficient for structure for a national life. So from this passage, it's clear that, you know, an apolitical life is supposed to be, you know, something to be aspired for before politics spoils relationships. That's what they're talking about. See, it seems an apolitical life is being treated as a luxury. And this is not a luxury that India can afford, right? Especially, you know, given the situation at that point, right, where reforms, even though the so-called reforms, you know, were meant to make Indians happy, it was not something that was actually giving Indians any power, right? So an apolitical life, although it was treated as a luxury, was not something that Indians could afford at that point. The novel, written over a period of 12 years of political and social change, has several anachronisms in it. Anachronisms means like it doesn't, the time and what happens at that particular time does not seem to match. Okay. Chronos is a god of time. Chronos. Okay. Anachronism, where is what is supposed to happen during a particular time does not happen at that time, and it's presented at a wrong time. So that becomes an anachronism. So the novel that was written over a period of 12 years, you know, has several anachronisms in it, because the social times and the historical changes are not put in at the right time. For example, in the depiction of Sir Gilbert, the lieutenant governor of the province, he assigns a post that had become defunct in 1924. So look at that. There is a mistake there, right? So he's, you know, he's given one of the characters, that is Sir Gilbert, who is presented as a lieutenant governor of the province. The British pronunciation is lieutenant governor, but if it's American, it becomes a lieutenant. He assigns a post that had become defunct in 1924. So this post itself did not exist in 1924. It had become defunct. So that is an anachronism. So he's talking about something that was not in existence at the time that he was writing. That becomes an example of an anachronism. His intention could have been to show how the new officials were as inept as the older ones. Of course, as a writer of fiction, he does have, you know, that power of fiction, you know, that he can use, right? And probably he was presenting to us this character, Sir Gilbert, whose position was no longer present in the time in which Sir Gilbert is presented as a character. That position had become defunct, not functional anymore. Yet he presents a character like Sir Gilbert in order to show us that these colonial officers were as inept or as inefficient as the older ones. Now, in 1921-22, in fact, okay, factually what was happening. So, Foster's second visit took place at this time, okay? After their support of the British war effort, Indians were excited. They were expectant of greater role in self-government. Instead, the Montagu-Chelmsford reforms, which led to the Act of 1919, were draconian measures providing for arrest and trial without any legal cover. So Rowlatt Act, you know, where that was one of the very notorious acts passed by the British, right? The Rowlatt Act. So Montagu-Chelmsford reforms led to the 1919 Act, where, see, arrest and trial without any legal cover was okayed. Okay, it was agreed upon. Okay, then came, you know, this was what actually we can say, you know, like the massacre of Jallianwala Bagh in 1990. And the other thing that happened at this time is the emergence of Gandhi and this coordination of the freedom struggle. Came the call in 1921 for Satyagraha, or non-violent non-cooperation, which meant good ethical and sound practical politics. So in factual, in reality, these were the things that was happening. Indians had helped the British during the World War, and in return they expected more power in their own land. In India, they expected to get more power in ruling India. Yet it was a false hope. The British did not live up to the expectations that the Indians had. Rather, they passed draconian measures. They passed terrible measures, like the Act of 1919, whereby arrest and trial could be conducted by the British without any proper trial, without any legal cover for it. And also the time when the terrible calamity, the terrible catastrophe of Jallianwala Bagh took place. Now, this was also the time when Gandhiji called for Satyagraha, and non-violent, non-cooperative movements became more and more important. Now, going on. See, the political landscape of 1921-22, a sense of multifaceted struggle. Okay. Now, first, there is a sense of multifaceted struggle in politics, religion, agrarian uprisings, labor revolts, all of these things happening together. Next, the emergence of Indian nationalism goes together with the rise of religious fundamentalism, not necessarily marked by national interest. So this also is the time then, beyond Indian nationalism, which should have united the people of India, right? Also, at this time, is this feeling of religious fundamentalism, which was dividing the national interest, right? When religious fundamentalism comes into the play, nationalism takes a second seat, and also this whole concept of national interest, undivided national interest gets broken down. Then the other important aspect of this is the related problems of relationships between national movement and extra-national movement. So historically, this was a time that there was a pan-Islamic movement for restoration of power to Turkey called as the Khilafat movement. And that was also brought into this situation. Okay, it was one such agitation that was taking place at that time, which was extra-national movement, not in within national movement, but outside of that. Also, the coming of Gandhi, the first genuinely all-Indian leader of the freedom struggle. So in reality, these were the things that was happening at that time, okay, 21-22. Now, in fiction, what was happening? A Passage to India orchestrates at a crucial moment the notion of subaltern protest, right? The subalterns, the colonized people. This was a time that they were rising up together to protest against the colonizers. And A Passage to India is something that is actually charting the course of this subaltern protest. Marginalized people are shown to come together against injustice sanctioned by imperial rule. So marginalized people everywhere are coming together to protest against imperial rule. An excellent example is the way in which the minority groups protest against the imprisonment of Aziz on the morning of his trial. So one of the characters, one of the central characters of the novel, Dr. Aziz, is imprisoned. And when he is imprisoned, all the members of the marginalized or minority groups come together. All the Muslim factions come together to protest against it. Now, first, it cuts across barriers of class and gender to include sweepers and women respectively. So minority groups, not only religiously, but also across class and gender, gather together to protest against the imprisonment of Dr. Aziz, which is represented by even the sweepers and the women coming forward, I mean, women are also a part of the minority group, right? Especially, like the sweepers, you can say, represent untouchability, etc. The women are also minority because their voices are also never heard. They're under parda. So all of these, even the parda-clad women came forward to protest against Aziz's imprisonment. Next, from the point of view of a detached British observer, the protest is shown to be partial. The strike will soon be broken, whether it is the sweepers or the women folk. But see, as far as in the novel, as far as a British observer is concerned, they understand that this is not a strike, this is not a protest that is going to be very effective. It is only going to be partial. The strike will soon be broken, whether it's the sweepers or the women folk. The strike is not going to be long lasting. And the single most amazing erasure in the novel is that of Gandhi. Gandhi is not written about in this novel. So, as far as the passage to India is concerned, one of the most striking erasures or like lack of mention is that of Gandhi. Now, there is an excerpt given from your text where it is described, how the sweepers had come and they had struck, etc. I'll just read that for you. Okay? The sweepers had just struck. Half the commodes of Chandrapur remained desolate in consequence. This was a time when, the latrines needed these sweepers to come and empty these latrines. Okay? But when they struck, all that job, all that work got came to a standstill. So only half and sweepers from the district who felt less strongly about the innocence of Dr. Aziz would arrive in the afternoon and break the strike. But why should the grotesque incident occur? So see, half the sweepers did not agree with Dr. Aziz's innocence. He was imprisoned because he was accused by the British of having assaulted a white woman called Adela. Now, half of the people believed in the innocence of Dr. Aziz, but there was a section that did not believe in his innocence. So these people would come, and that is how the strike would be broken. Then, and a number of Mohammedan ladies had sworn to take no food until the prisoner was acquitted. Their death would make little difference. Indeed, being invisible, they seemed dead already. So a lot of women had joined the protest, but these women did not were not of any consequence. They did not figure in this whole narrative because they were already invisible and as such did not they were like dead already. They did not make any difference to the whole narrative or the protest. They were not important as far as the protest is concerned. Nevertheless, it was disquieting. A new spirit seemed abroad, a rearrangement which no one in the stern little band of whites could explain. So something was happening, and the whites could not comprehend actually what was happening. So this is how we can compare what was happening in reality with what is happening in the novel. Then in Letters and Essays, Foster's 1921 to 22 visit was spent by him in the princely state of Devas, now which is part of Madhya Pradesh, as a secretary to its Maharaja. Devas is presented in the novel as a place called Mau. Foster lived and worked in a state that was even more opposed to progress and freedom struggle than British India. So Mau was a state that is that kind of agreed with the British rule. So in that sense, it was even more colonial than even the British India. When Foster writes the most Indian section of his novel, namely Temple, he cannot write of Gandhi. He could not write of Gandhi because Gandhi was anti-colonial, right? Anti-British. And he was working for a king who was for the British rule, who supported the British rule. So therefore, Foster could not write about Gandhi in his novel. Another possible reason for the exclusion of Gandhi from the novel is Foster's intensely ambiguous attitude to the freedom struggle. Why talk about the attitude of his employer? He himself had a very ambiguous attitude towards this whole freedom struggle question. Foster himself. Knowledge would mean power. The rural people are the uneducated rural masses. Since they have no knowledge and they can enjoy their state of freedom from responsibility as they know better. This was the kind of view that he held, the rural people, they don't have knowledge and as such, they're enjoying their life free from responsibility. So, because knowledge is power, right? So he had that kind of a limited viewpoint about this. Then going on to the next one. 1945 and after, okay, outside the novel. The prophetic note in A Passage to India relates to events which took place after 1924 and were foreseen by the novel. So the prophetic note in A Passage to India, I mean, 1945 and after, okay? In the novel, you find certain things that Foster is mentioning, which seems to be prophetic. So why is there this prophetic note, okay? See, the prophetic note in A Passage to India relates to events which took place after 1924 and were foreseen in the novel. So the novel kind of prophecies that such things could happen. To begin with, there was a Second World War, which happened from 1939 to 1945, which, while it ended in victory for Britain and her allies, also foreshadowed in the rise of the United States of America and the weakening of the Empire. It also foreshadowed the hastening of independence of the South Asian colonies. So, although in the World War, in the World War, the Allies won the war, we can say the victory of the Allies happened in the Second World War, but it was foreshadowed by the weakening of the colonial enterprise in the South Asian colonies. India gained independence in 1947 at the cost of partition. She went on to see various wars after that, right? With China in 62, with Pakistan in 65 and 71. Gandhiji was assassinated in 1949. Foster was conscious that with the passage of time, his novel would increasingly suggest an India that could not be recovered. So India was changing, and his novel seemed to talk about an India that could be in the past, that could never be recovered. So, as prophesied by the novel, the novel anticipates certain political events and trends. Aziz is made to predict Second World War in a way that many Indians in real life might have done. So, just as many Indians in real life might have anticipated the Second World War, Aziz also talks about it. The way in which the conclusion of the novel handles the developing trends of nationalism and internationalism is important, is significant. Fielding's conversation with Aziz, India, a nation, what an apotheosis. Apotheosis means climax, okay? India, a nation. So Fielding, another character in the novel who's the school headmaster, he's talking to his friend Dr. Aziz. So Fielding, a British man, and Dr. Aziz, an Indian, right? They are having this conversation, and Fielding is saying, India, a nation, what an apotheosis. So what a climax, okay? Last comer to the drab 19th century sisterhood. So almost like one who became a nation. The last, okay, one who joined the sisterhood of newly formed nations, the last one to join the sisterhood of newly formed nations, waddling in at this hour of the world to take her seat. She whose only peer was the Holy Roman Empire. She shall rank with Guatemala and Belgium, perhaps. Quote from A Passage to India, page 315. Okay, so the image that is shown here, you know, is of a nation, of our nation, of India, shuffling in like a latecomer, because to the outmoded 19th century concept of a nation state. So Fielding is making fun of India, you know, coming in late and almost not even walking with confidence, shuffling in into this concept of a nation state. Now, there is also the regret that India, which once headed an imperial system which was as powerful as the Roman Empire, is now to lose her dignity and be placed next to states like, you know, small states like Guatemala or Belgium. So we also find Foster mocking Indian aspirations of nationalism. So this is Foster telling us, you know, through Fielding, it's actually Foster himself who's sort of, you know, mocking India's aspirations of becoming a nation. In the novel, Aziz's poetry, you know, they struck a new note. There cannot be a motherland without new homes. In one poem, only one funny old Godbole like. Godbole is another character who worked for Fielding, okay? He's a Hindu person, and he is portrayed as someone who understands the mystic side of India. So the only one funny old Godbole like. We're talking about the poems that Aziz used to write. And one particular poem, the one that Godbole liked, okay? He had skipped over the motherland, whom he did not truly love, and gone straight to internationality. So in one of Aziz's poems, he had begun by straight away talking over nationalism to internationalism. And this is how Godbole reacted to it. Ah, that is bhakti. Ah, my young friend. That is different and very good. Ah, India, who seems not to move, will go straight there while the other nations waste their time. So Passage to India, page 290. So Godbole understands that poem. And he says that India will go not to nationality, but straight to internationality. Will not. Now it seems as if India is not moving, but India will move fast and fast into a level of internationality. That means we'll become a power on an international level. So here, nationalism is important on, you know, three reasons nationalism is important. One, to make people feel at home. Second, as a step to internationalism. And third, there is a feeling that India might skip ahead of nationalism to internationalism and take its place in the world. So this is, these are some of the things that you find in the novel, which seems to be like a prophecy, right? These things did happen, did come to happen later on. So almost like a prophecy. So you find the prophecy of the Second World War happening in the novel. Then you find how, you know, the concept of India as a nation state is kind of mocked by Fielding. Also, we can say it is Foster himself who seems to have that opinion. And also how in Aziz's poetry, we find that India will go straight on to become a powerful international power. Then, role of history and philosophy. Okay, how is history and philosophy influencing the theme of this novel? So here, let me read a little bit from your text. Okay, see, I began to write the novel in 1913. Foster says, okay, I began to write the novel in 1913, but the First World War intervened, and it did not get published until 1924. Needless to say, it dates, right? It dates means it becomes old, it becomes out of date. The India I described has been transformed politically and greatly changed socially. I also tried to describe human beings. These may not have altered so much. Furthermore, taking my title from a poem of Walt Whitman's, I tried to indicate the human predicament in a universe which is not so far comprehensible to our minds. So politically, historically, everything might have changed, but then I have tried to describe human beings. They do not change, right? Human beings, the human characteristic, that does not change. That's what we say. Furthermore, taking my title from a poem of Walt Whitman's, I try to indicate human predicament in a universe which is not comprehensible to our minds. So the human predicament, the human difficulties, the hu human dilemmas, which is, you know, beyond what we can understand. This is how he is talking about this novel. The book is not really about politics, though it is political, though it is a political aspect that caught the general public and made it sell. It's about something wider than politics, about the search of the human race for a more lasting home, about the universe as embodied in the Indian earth and the Indian sky. It is, or rather, desires to be philosophic and poetic. So there has been question, you know, earlier about when does he become more philosophic rather than historic in the novel. So here he's talking about it himself. You know, this is a quote from himself. So the book is not about politics, although politics is there and the political aspect is what has made the book so popular. It's not only about politics. It's more than that. It's something which is wider than politics. It is about the human race and how does the human race look at itself under the Indian sky, on Indian earth? How do they see themselves as human beings? That's what I want to try to find out. So this is a quote from Foster. Foster here accomplishes a shift from a historical towards a philosophical interest in this treatment of India. So historically, many things have happened, right? And he's saying it's not more of history of politics, but it's also about the philosophy of what is India. Then Foster's interest is not primarily in a historical representation of India as an end in itself. His intention was to write a novel with a metaphysical search as its subject, holding universal interest. So a metaphysical, you know, understanding of what is India. A metaphysical is like the soul or the sense of what lies in the essence of India. That's what he wanted to understand, more than a historical representation of India. Now, the consequences for reading, okay? Historicist reading of the novel. So a historicist reading of the novel, which moves on the lines of historical pressures, which registers itself through predicates of race, class, and gender, will be reading against the grain of the text. If you read it only from a historical perspective, talking only about race, class, and gender, we will be losing out. Next, it opens up an alternative space within which ahistorical forces such as religion can be examined. So, ahistorical forces means forces that are not historical, like religion. So, understanding religion in India, that's another aspect of it. Finally, it will enable the reader to see history and philosophy not as oppositional forces in the novel, but as cooperating to construct various representations of India. So, if you look at the philosophical reading of A Passage to India, it will help the reader to see history and philosophy not as opposing one another, but rather as forces that are acting together, cooperating together, or acting together to create what is essentially known as India. So none of these elements exist in totally watertight compartments. They all go together to form what is India. Now let us just have a look at. So those were the, you know, some of the critical things that we had to talk about this novel. Now let's talk about the characters and a quick plot summary of this movie, okay? Because I've been mentioning Aziz and God Bowling and Fielding. I don't know whether see, some of you, at least some of you, are familiar with these names. But anyway, let me talk about who these characters are. So main characters, see, Dr. Aziz. He's a Mohammedan, that means a Muslim, Indian doctor. People like him a lot. He wants to be friends with the English, but ends up being sorry. He's friendly and eager to please. Then there is Mr. Turton, who's a collector, a British man. Then there is Mr. Fielding, the British schoolmaster of Government College, who's around his late 40s, and he cannot understand why British and Indian cannot be friends. Then another character you meet is Ronnie Hislop. He's a British city magistrate. He's supposed to marry this girl called Adela Quested, and he thinks the British, the English are better than the Indians. Then Major Callender, British civil surgeon, who's the boss of Aziz. Then Muhammad Ali, who's a friend of Aziz. He's a lawyer who's a friend of Aziz. Then Hamidullah, is an uncle of Aziz and also his friend, uncle and friend of Aziz. Then there is Mrs. Moore, that is Ronnie's mother, British woman who's Ronnie's mother, an older woman who thinks everyone is equal regardless of race. So a woman who is able to see an Indian and a British as equals. Okay. Miss Adela Quested, British fiance to Ronnie Hislop. She's all prim and proper and thinks she wants to be friends with the Indians, but in the end she finds she cannot. Okay. Adela Quested is coming to India for the first time, and she has intentions of marrying Ronnie Hislop, and she wants to know what is a real India beyond the India that is shown to her by the Britishers. She wants to know what is the real India, wants to become friends with Indians, but later finds that she cannot. Then Professor Godbole, the Hindu Indian, a man who works for Fielding. Okay? He's a teacher who is, distant from the conflicts between the races, who keeps himself away from the conflicts between the races. Some typing error is there. Please ignore that. The next part. So, Passage to India is divided into three parts. Now we have met the main characters. Oh, by the way, the picture here is, you can see the train there. It's from the film, okay? That's the film Passage to India. If you search on YouTube, you might be able to find it. Then, so you can see this is a place. They are going on a picnic to Malabar Caves, okay? And they're going in this train, Malabar Express. You can see the train there. And looking out from the train window is Mrs. Moore, the older lady, and Adela Quested. So they are the ones who are going to Malabar Caves. Now, Passage to India is divided into three parts: mosque, cave, and temple. Each part corresponds to an emotional and plot emphasis. So let's see what it is. In the first part, readers are introduced to the range of Muslim and British characters that are primary focus of the novel. The single most important character in the novel is a Muslim doctor, Dr. Aziz. He encounters an important British character, Mrs. Moore, at his mosque. When he discovers that Mrs. Moore has known enough to leave her shoes at the entrance of the mosque, he feels a friendship for her that persists throughout the novel. She is in India to try to see the engagement of her son Ronnie to a young woman named Miss Quested. Dr. Aziz is a widower with two children. हेलो,
Amu.
Hello, Amu, can you hear me? Hello, Amu, can you hear me?
हेलो।
Someone has unmuted their microphones. It is Amu, I think, right? Someone called Amu. Can you please mute it? Hello, Amukuti, are you there? I hope you have muted your microphone. Okay, let me go back to presenting. Okay, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay,
Yes,
let's
yes.
go. So I was talking about what was I talking? Okay, so the passage to India, this novel is divided into three parts. Okay, there is a mosque, then there is a cave, and there is a temple. It's divided into three sections, the novel. Okay, first section is the mosque, then there is a cave, and then there is a temple. And each part talks to one emotional element. Okay, and the single most important character in the novel is the Muslim doctor, Dr. Aziz. And then there is this English woman, the lady, Mrs. Moore, that he meets at the mosque. And he understands that, you know, she is not a typical insensitive colonial woman. Because, you know, how does he understand that? When she visits the mosque, she puts her footwear outside. So she's sensitive to the customs that are followed in the mosque. You know, she doesn't walk in with her shoes, which would be. Which would be against the code of conduct in the mosque. So he feels, you know, he kind of feels that he can be friends with her because generally Dr. Aziz does not feel that he can be friends with the British. But with Mrs. Moore, he finds that there is a difference. Now, why is she in India? She is in India to see the engagement of her son Ronnie to a young woman named Miss Quested, Miss Adela Quested. So Dr. Aziz is a widower with three children. Then the two British women desire to see a more authentic side of India than what is possible through British clubs and theatre performances. Dr. Aziz arranges an excursion for them to the Malabar Caves. Although Miss Quested had begun to think that she and Ronnie were not suited to each other, after a peculiar car accident in which no one is injured but in which the cause of the accident remains unclear, Miss Quested decides that she and Ronnie are right for each other and they become engaged. So Adela wants to see the real India, the unseen side of India. You know, when Mrs. Moore and Adela come to India, the British section of society hosts a tea party for them where the Indians are also called. But the two sections remain disjointed, they don't mingle. And Adela feels that she has not seen the real India. It's a very artificial picture of India that she feels she has seen. She wants to see the real India. And although she's come with intentions to marry Ronnie, she's not very sure about her feelings to Ronnie. And at one point, they have an accident, and then she feels, okay, I can get engaged to Ronnie. That's how the situation is. Now, they plan a trip to Malabar Caves. Okay, at the party, they meet some Indians, and Dr. Aziz also is there. And Dr. Aziz tells that I will make arrangements for a party for a picnic to this Malabar Caves. Now, the trip to the caves and the consequences of it are in the fo are the focus in part two. Okay, the second part. So first is the mosque, then the caves, and then the temple. Mrs. Moore hears a strange echo in one of the caves and decides that the echo points to a meaninglessness in the universe. So, if you look at it symbolically, you know, the first part, which is called mosque, and the last part called the temple, they're all like religion-based, in a way, you can say searching for God kind of based, okay? But the middle one, which is a caves, okay, which is as we read earlier, you know, unclassified, something that cannot be fully explained, that part of life. Okay, that it's almost symbolic there. The caves become like a symbol of an uncharted territory where they go, but they're not, you know, the mysticism, the mysteriousness, the strangeness becomes too much, more than what these women can understand or take. So when Mrs. Moore comes into, although it is a metaphor, you know, in the novel, what happens is that when Mrs. Moore gets into the cave, she feels that she is able to hear these strange echoes, which completely disorients her, and she does not want to go further to explore the other caves there. So she goes out of the cave and decides to wait outside. And Adela Quested and Dr. Aziz go on to explore the other caves. At one point, Adela asks Dr. Quested about polygamy because he is a Muslim. She asks him about polygamy, which kind of, you know, he becomes insulted with that question. And he goes to another cave to have a smoke. And then what he sees is that, you know, this girl has left, okay? And when they go back, when he goes outside the cave, he finds that Adela has left along with Mrs. Moore. They have gone back. And when he reaches Chandrapur, he is arrested by the British soldiers, saying that he has been accused by Adela of molesting her. So that becomes, you know, so the cave becomes the point where all this conflict rises. Now let's read this and see. See, Mrs. Moore hears a strange echo in one of the caves, and decides that the cave points to, or the echo points to, a meaninglessness in the universe. So she feels that, you know, there is no point in existence. That this is a metaphorical side of the meaning. So this unpleasant experience makes her want to return to England. Miss Quested somehow imagines that Dr. Aziz assaults her in one of the caves. She leaves hurriedly with Miss Derek, a British woman who has come in another car, without explaining her departure to anyone. Dr. Aziz looks for her, only to discover that she is gone. When the remaining group returns to the city of Chandrapur, Dr. Aziz is arrested for assaulting Miss Quested. The British are outraged at the assault, which they think shows the nature of Indians and confirms in their own minds the necessity of their presence in India. The Indians are also outraged at what is an unjust accusation and a difficult charge to defend against. And the same thing happens in To Kill a Mockingbird also, you know. There's a white woman who accuses a black person of having molested her. So it's very hard to defend, right? The black person, although he has not done any wrong, it's very hard to defend in such accusations. So the same thing happens here to Dr. Aziz also. As an Indian, you know, he's been accused by a white woman of molesting her. So it's very hard for the lawmakers at that time to listen to Dr. Aziz's voice. So community relations become severely strained during the trial. The Muslim friends of Dr. Aziz arranged to get him a talented anti-British Hindu lawyer from Calcutta. As the trial is proceeding, Miss Quested begins to have doubts about her testimony. She develops in her own mind the sound of the echo heard earlier by Mrs. Moore in the cave. She recognizes that Dr. Aziz did not follow her into the cave and assault her. When she says this, the British case against Dr. Aziz falls apart and they must set him free. Also, during this section, the news arrives that Mrs. Moore, you know, who has gone back to England, has died on the way. She doesn't reach England back ever. She died after departure from Bombay. The telegram came from Aden and she was buried at sea in the Red Sea. In the remainder of the novel, entitled Temple, a Hindu festival is celebrated. The reader learns that Mr. Fielding is going to marry Stella Moore, Mrs. Moore's daughter. For a while, Dr. Aziz has labored under the mistaken assumption that Fielding, his one British friend, is going to marry Miss Quested. Then they remain friends at the end of the novel, but things cannot resume their formal status between the Indian community in general and the British in general, nor are things exactly on the same footing between Fielding and Dr. Rezies. Their friendship also becomes changed, you know, completely transformed by what happens in the Marabar case. So the main thing, you know, whatever happens is the incident that happens at the Marabar case. And looking at it metaphorically, it's like, you know, the echoes are something that unsettles Mrs. Moore and seems to disorient Adela, and she seems to believe that Dr. Rezies molested her in the cave. But later she understands that, you know, she realizes that it was a mistaken idea that she had, and she takes back her accusation of Dr. Aziz. And so the British point of view of the case does not hold up, and Dr. Aziz is set free. But even though he's set free, you know, the relationships between the British characters and this Indian characters become strained. So that's what is basically happening in the novel. Now going on, race, class and gender in A Passage to India. Foster's handling of both character and incident has been criticized. One, for not exploring the minds of his British characters from within. Two, gender portrayal is unsound in the novel, especially for the British women in the in this novel. So Fielding has been criticized for, you know, first not exploring the minds of the British characters from within. That's what is said, you know, when you read, the British characters are not given so much of importance or not really in-depth characters. Okay. Second one is the women characters are not portrayed, you know, very soundly in the novel. There is, you know, the gender portrayal is not very clear in this novel. Third, criticism against, you know, his character and incident is that catchwords, gossip and conversation lead to inaccurate delineation of character and incident. And fourthly, people and events seem improbable because they have not been observed with either historical or psychological accuracy. So generally, there is a criticism against Foster that the characters have not been given the kind of depth that they required, whether it is women characters, whether it is British characters. Now, Foster replies to these criticisms by pointing out that even in history, as with respect to history, you know, there are several anachronisms, etc., that we have seen earlier. So Foster's reply points out that in time of historic unfairness, reflected in the colonial conquest, it's not possible for a novelist to aim at psychological fairness while dealing with both the colonizer and the colonized. So this was a time of historic unfairness, right? Historic unfairness because colonial conquest, right? The Indians were the actually marginalized community here, right? So it's a time of colonial conquest. It's a time of colonial unfairness. And Foster says that it's not possible for a novelist to aim at psychological fairness when he is writing about both the colonizer and the colonized. And he is, you know, protecting himself by saying that he attempts to redress the balance by positive discrimination, that is, discrimination in favor of the Indians. So he's saying, my Indian characters are given more importance because I wanted, in this case, in my novel, I wanted to discriminate positively and show more consideration towards the Indian characters and less importance to the British characters. This is how he explained it. The novel also brings out how race divide has also resulted in an economic divide. For example, you know, the Britishers live in posh surroundings, whereas the locals or the natives live in shanties, like, you know, huts. This is how it's described in the book, you know, the club, very opulent furnishings and surroundings, as opposed to the, you know, basic house in which Aziz lives, which is referred to as a shanty. Shanty is like, you know, a hut, almost like a hut. that race, the question of race. Okay, Aziz, the very first character to whom reader is introduced is initially all animation, very talkative, okay, and resolutely apolitical. He's not bothered with the political questions there. It's through him that the world of the novel is introduced. He avoids speaking of the English, not because they are colonizers, but because they bring discord into the conversation when he would rather shut them out and be jolly with his friends. So he believes in having a good time, and talking about the Britishers would bring discordance into their talk. So he leaves out talking about the British. His meeting with Mrs. Moore at the mosque is important to him because he forms this bond of sympathy that is instinctively achieved or established between them. And again, when Aziz is asked how he has planned an outing that cuts across race divide, he insists that the picnic is an expedition of friends and has nothing to do with racial origins of its members. So when he arranges this picnic to Marabar Cave, you know, many people ask him, you know, how is he going to cut across this race divide, the race of the white man versus the Indians? How is he going to cut across that? But then he tells them that, you know, picnic is about friends, a group of friends, not about the racial divide at all. Yet when he goes there, you know, he also becomes trapped in this old colonial context because of how Adila accuses him. Now, the historical and the psychological seem to merge in the way he feels depressed entering civil lines, leading to Major Callender's compound. So Major Callender is his boss, and when he turns to that road leading to Major Callender's house, he starts feeling depressed. So that's a symbol of, you know, what happens to the colonized people, right? Historical and psychological seems to be coming together there. Mentally, they feel, you know, how the colonized people feel unhappy in such a situation. He interprets Fielding's dismissal of art to mean that as an Indian, he must be ignorant of art. So when Fielding dismisses art, you know, Aziz feels that Fielding is dismissing Aziz himself as being ignorant of art. The colonial context breaks Aziz's personality down after the Marabar case. And after the Marabar case, the trial in the court, the colonial context completely breaks him down. His personality is shattered after that case of this British woman accusing him of rape. He retreats to Mau, the princely state, which is even more backward. So from Chandrapur, he drops his career and he goes to this far off state called Mau. And Mau is a state which is even more backwards in the way it looks at, you know, the Indian quest for freedom or religion, all of these things. So Aziz is enthusiastic about his profession. In fact, he's even a better doctor than Major Callender, his boss. He's also very careless. He drinks unboiled water himself after treating a patient for typhoid. So as a doctor, he's a smart man, but also very careless, because after treating someone for typhoid, he himself goes and drinks unboiled water. Now, under colonialism, Aziz also changes, you know, especially his poetry changes. At the start, Aziz's enthusiasm for poetry is genuine and contagious. He quotes from poems which say India has always been Muslim and hence they will have a kingly role to play in it. Yet we find that towards the end, maybe due to the pressures of political harassment, the subject of his poetic interest changes to social questions such as nationalism and the position of women. So after his experience, you know, even his poetry changes, and his poetry now talks more about nationalism, less about Muslim superiority, and more about India as a nation, and also the subjugated position of women. Okay? And then Aziz Fielding's friendship is always tinged with colonial situation, and even in their friendly arguments, the question of race, color, and differences inevitably crops up. Okay, so Aziz and Fielding, you know, the Indian with the white man, the friendship between them, there is always this question of race and color and differences in their lives that comes up. Then look at this character, God Bole. See, in the picture, the central character, the one sitting in the middle, is God Bole. So he's a professor at the government college in Chandrapur, where Fielding is a principal, and he's introduced apparently as a figure of fun. So this is how he is described. He wore a turban, coat, waistcoat, dhoti, socks with clocks, you know, the print of clocks on the socks, as if he had reconciled the products of the East and West, mental as well as physical. So quite a mix of, you know, Eastern attire and Western attire, like you could say fusion, right? So mentally also and physically also, he seemed to have, you know, reconciled both the East and the West. His clothes are a laughable combination of two cultures. He is greedy. He misses the Marabar picnic because he has miscalculated the length of a prayer, and he dances in foolish abandon on the occasion of Janmashtami. When Fielding questions him about his feelings on Aziz's arrest, he says both good and evil are aspects of God and represent respectively God's presence and God's absence. Evil too is part of the complex reality of God. So so he is able to reconcile himself to the East and the West, and has, you know, he's a picture of fusion. And even in his concept of you know, good and bad, he has he says that, you know, both God and evil are, you know, present everywhere. So evil is also part of the complex reality of God. So evil is not something like God would exist only if there is devil, right? So devil and God, you know, are not two different entities. They are part and parcel of the whole, the one whole picture. So Said's paradigm applied to Foster's treatment of God Bole. Edward Said's example applied to Foster's treatment of God Bole. Said suggests that Europe has traditionally constructed the Orient as other than itself, right? Orient, or the entire East, as other, as something different from itself. With the Orient as mysterious, irrational, and therefore vulnerable, both politically and imaginatively, to the organizing, governing powers of the West. The West is always seen as rationalizing, you know, less emotion and more rationalism. And the East is always seen as, you know, more irrational, more emotional, more vulnerable. This is how Europe has always portrayed the East with respect to the West, or the Orient with respect to the powers of the West. Now, Foster takes this notion of Englishness as a normative here. Aziz is described in terms not of race, but of religion, as a Muslim, and God Bole as ancient knight, unknowable, irrational, as Said's theory suggests, and vulnerable because inferior to systems of coherent, rational thought, such as those exhibited by the West and by Islam. So when Foster describes Aziz, okay, he is described in terms of religion, and God Bole is described in terms of irrationality, in terms of unknowableness. No one can know exactly what God Bole is thinking, and also vulnerable because, you know, he is not able to stick to rational ways of thought, which is symbolically represented by the West and by Islam. So he's someone exactly like Edward Said's example of the description of the Orient. Now, Foster's characterization of God Bole relies heavily in cultural stereotyping when it is placed within the context of social comedy. within the context of comedy. Then Fielding. So the character of Fielding. This is a picture of Fielding that you can see. On the left side is Dr. Aziz and on the right side is Dr. Fielding. Okay? So Fielding is introduced as a character who is suspected of being unsound by his compatriots in India because he associates socially with Indians and educates them. Because he mixes with Indians, the other Westerners, other Englishmen think that he's unsound. Education implies the encouragement of ideas and free thought. At the tea party, he tackles a race problem. He stays with the Indian guests. So the, on one side are the Indian guests, on the other side are the English guests. And Fielding stays with the English, with the Indian guests, sorry. He invites Adila and Mrs. Moore to tea with Aziz and Godbole only because he knows these English women will not discriminate against Indians. So the other English women would not find it easy to mix with Indians. So he, Fielding knows that, and that's why Fielding calls Adila and Mrs. Moore for a tea, to have tea with Godbole and Dr. Aziz. No. Fielding's ideas are based on liberal humanism, ideas of Foster himself. Okay, where he considers all human beings as equal. And he is one of the Englishmen who mixes with the Indians. Then, see, liberal humanism. What is it about? See, people are important in terms of their individualism and more important than organizations and systems. This is what liberal humanism is about. Okay, people are individuals who are more important than systems and organizations. Then, secondly, such like-minded individuals can be found throughout human history, cutting across cultures and classes. There is the sense that such relationships are best safeguards against brute force. So, liberal humanism, where individuals are given importance and considered beyond, more important than systems and establishments. And there is a belief that, you know, if such relationships can be formed, you know, cutting across cultures and classes, this is the best solution that we can have against brute forces. So liberal humanism is closely related to the love or the world of the heart. So Fielding believes in that. Okay, liberal humanism. Now, how does this go with the characterization of Fielding? This concept of liberal humanism, how can we attach it to the characterization of Fielding? One, he befriends Aziz wholly, setting aside the racial divide. He remains on Aziz's side, even when to do so means that Fielding is cut dead by the entire British community. Thirdly, when he befriends Adela, he does so because she has been a loser, not considering her race. Fielding is ready to recognize the impulse of love in Hinduism, however ignorant he may be of religion. So when you think about liberal humanism and how you can connect it with the character of Fielding, these are the points you have to remember. See, he becomes a friend of Dr. Aziz. Okay, not thinking about the racial divide at all. Secondly, even when all the English community, the British community has turned against Dr. Aziz because of the accusation of rape, Dr. Fielding is on his side, okay, goes against the entire British community. Then he becomes friendly to Adela, friendly with Adela Quested. And he does not become friendly with her because she is a British woman. Not because of that, but because she has suffered. Apparently, you know, whatever the trial and all the, and how she, when she takes back her charge against Dr. Aziz, you know, the British community kind of abandons her. So through all that, Adela has suffered and Fielding stands by her because of her suffering. Then Fielding is ready to recognize the impulse of love in Hinduism. So he knows very little about religion, but he does recognize this element of love that is presented in Hinduism. So then in all those respects, we can say that, you know, Foster is giving Fielding all the requisites of a liberal humanist. However, in A Passage to India, Foster explores the limitations of the philosophy of liberal humanism. How does he explore the limitations of this theory, liberal humanism? How does he explore its limitations? Let's see how. Okay. First point, it's potentially damaging for any philosophy to set aside an existing political or social context. So any philosophy that does not take into consideration the existing political or social context can only have damaging effects. Second point, on a personal level, Fielding forgets that the colonial context itself denies the colonized any semblance of human dignity and sense of humanity. It denies. So, however much he may try to become friendly with the colonized, he has forgotten that he, as a member of the colonizing group of people, colonizing race, he is part and parcel of the problem, right? He's one of the people who is denying the colonized any sense of humanity, any sense of self. So there, this liberal humanism fails. When you take it at a higher level, it fails. Third point, political level. Fielding seems to be unsympathetic to India's nationalistic aspirations. Like any British man, like any Englishman, he does not sympathize with India's wish to form a nation of its own. And then fourth point, in that sense, liberal humanism is not a forward-looking philosophy. It sees only one true human tradition. Just as Fielding always believes in Western European cultural values alone. So one true human, tradition. What is that one true human tradition? That means it discounts for all the pluralities that might exist, all the multicultural aspects that might exist, right? So as a white man, he believes that the one truly human tradition that exists is the Western European cultural value alone. So that does not really add to this liberal humanism thing, right? So those are the ways in which, limitations of the cultural humanism is brought in by Foster. So liberal humanism is an ineffective instrument for social and political change, right? Just considering all people as equal without implementing, changes in the level of politics or society, it does not really bring in any change, right? So it does not suggest any cause for social action. So without social action or political action, this concept of liberal humanism just sounds hollow. There is no space in the colonial framework for personal relationships if they pretend the race divide does not exist. Okay, so going on to the next one. Now, how is class represented? People from various classes, how are they represented in the novel? So the unorganized sector, people in the novel who are without any bargaining power because they lack the education and the money. The novel engages with subcultures in India, people cut off from socio-economic realities. Although it seems radical at this point, it also raises the question whether Foster's depiction of the marginalized, for example, the Pankawala, a servant in Fielding's tea party, servant at Janmashtami celebrations, so this Pankawala, people in the marginalized community, does not intensify their marginalization. So, people who are cut off from the socio-economic reality, such people are presented in the novel. But then, how are they presented? Presentation of such characters, for example, the Pankawala or the servant at the Janmashtami celebrations. So does Foster's presentation of them intensify their marginalization? This is the question that comes up. Now let's look at the Pankawala, for example. Okay, the Pankawala in the courtroom is presented as a type of male beauty. he's outside any cultural, social, or economic background of any reader of the novel and seems objectified in this presentation. So there is no reader, whether it is Indian or non-Indian, okay, who is from his same social class, you can say, cultural or social background or economic background. So in that sense, when he is described as a type of male beauty, he can say he is objectified. He is presented as an object. Okay, he is not seen as an individual, rather as an object. So Foster uses the Pankhawala to challenge positions of race and class maintained by Adela and her supporters as they enter the room. They are middle-level administrators of the ruling race. He is an outcast, a pollutant, expelled from the ranks even of the ruled. So there is a big difference between, you know, these white women and the Pankhawala. First of all, these white women represent the middle-level administrators of the ruling class. And the Pankhawala is not only not part of the ruling race, he is also one of the ostracized even among the ruled people, right? Even amongst Indians, he would be on a lower strata. So then Foster uses Pankhawala to show that ultimately the watertight compartments that categorize human experience are of no consequence. The race divide and the class divide are both meaningless. Moreover, his attitude to the trial is one of supreme unconcern. So it clearly brings out, you know, that there is, I mean, the class divide and the race divide is something which is both meaningless. And his attitude to the trial, you know, during the court scene, he's present in the court, but he is completely unconcerned with what is happening in the court. So his attitude to the trial is of supreme unconcern. His complete aloofness, in a sense, places the Marabar case in perspective, since he shows through his remoteness that it is unimportant. So in the larger picture, this Marabar case, Adela quested and all of that is unimportant. We see that it's insignificant when we look at the Pankhawala, okay, a member not of the ruling class, not even of the ruled class, one who is treated as an outcast by everyone. So the Pankhawala is not only objectified but also represented as a figure without a voice and without a thought of his own. So it's completely represented as, you know, an object and also as a voiceless person. So the servants at the tea party and at the festival are also presented as silenced characters. Foster presents these people as objects of desire without any inhibitions because both on account of their race and their class, they are exotic and therefore fit subjects for political and imaginative rule. So the kind of, you know, their lack of voice is something that makes them vulnerable and fit for political rule and imaginative rule. So this is how he presents, you know, the question of class in the novel. The example is that of the Pankhawala. Now, how are the Indian professionals portrayed in the novel? That's the next one. So Foster examines both Indian and British professionals. The former includes Aziz, Panna Lai, who are doctors, Hamidullah and Amrit Rao, who are barristers, and Das, the assistant magistrate, Mahmud Ali, the pleader, and Haq, the police inspector, Saeed Mohammed, the engineer. Most of the Indians in the novel are educated people, trained for their respective professions. The difficulties that even professional Indians face when they try to come together are many. Aziz and Godbole face a change and decline. After the trial, Aziz faces a decline. He retreats to this far-off state called Mau. So, that is what happens. So though they are professionals and educated, when they come together, you know, I mean, the problems that they face when they come together are many and most often end in decline. Then the question of gender, okay, In the question of gender, Mrs. Maud and Adela are prominent. So though they are born in elite society, they are still subaltern on account of their gender. So as women, they still belong to the marginalized section or the subaltern section. Mrs. Maud's vision of empire based on love is ridiculed by her son, Ron. So she has this, philosophy of love, universal vision of love throughout the empire. But her son, Ronnie, ridicules. And her intuitive love for Aziz leads Aziz to call her an Oriental. So the way she bonds with Aziz, is from intuition, from an instinct which is beyond any rationalism that we associate with the West. So in that way, Aziz calls her an Oriental, as he sees her as an Eastern soul. Like other marginalized characters, such as the Pankhawala, Mrs. Moore is silenced by the text. Okay, she does not believe that Aziz is guilty, and her voice is not allowed to be heard. That's why Ronnie, her son, sends her back to England. And unfortunately, she does not reach England also. So her voice is, symbolically lost at sea, right? Her body is buried at sea, and symbolically, she's voice of sanity, voice of love, which is silenced by the text. Ronnie dismisses her as she has no evidence to give in the court. Having made her voyage to India, she dies at sea. Neither as British ghost nor as an Indian deity, though, can Mrs. Moore speak. She's silenced on account of her gender. So her gender forces her to be silenced. And then the next one is Adela. Adela wants to see the real India, and a party is organized for this, but the India she's presented there is superficial. I mean, Aziz is a little suspicious of this attitude of Adela's, as he sees it only as a restatement of the British ambition to rule India. Her dry rationalism does not win her any support either from the British or from the Indians. She's very dry and very rational. Okay, she wants to see India and feels that, she will be able to understand India in just a short span of time. So that seems something, which makes Aziz a little bit suspicious about this girl. Like Mrs. Moore, though, Adela is also silenced, and we are not told what actually happens in the caves. So Adela's voice is also not presented with clarity, because we don't know what exactly she felt in the cave. So Adela is not heard, and also she's described as ugly and not fit to be seen either. So she's not described as beautiful or anything. And so she's again presented as a woman character who's silenced, fit to be not heard and not seen. Okay. And not given the power to express her feelings with clarity. Then representations of India and the religions that you see, we saw that the novel was divided into three sections, the mosque, the cave and the temple. So how are the religions presented in the novel? So Foster's attitude to the three major religions he encountered in his life, Christianity, Islam, Hinduism. He visited many mosques, temples, and wanted to extract meaningful experiences from various religions without becoming a worshipper in any. Okay? So how does he present Christianity? Foster and his generation had reason to be suspicious of the nexus between empire, commerce, and Christianity. So that Foster had seen how this colonialistic enterprise functioned, right? The machinery of the colonial enterprise, he had seen it at close quarters. So he knew that there was this, unholy nexus that existed between Christianity, commerce, that is money-making, and how to, rule and control the empire. Okay, so empire itself was, a machinery geared towards money making, right? And religion was just a tool for that. So he had seen at close quarters this nexus between empire, commerce, and Christianity. that had developed throughout the high noon of imperialism in the 19th century. Christianity had been used to give political conquest and moral legitimacy. So political conquest, and a moral reason for that. That was what religion was used as. At best of times, Foster distrusted missionary activity. So he never trusted this evangelical mission at all. And Mrs. Moore in the novel examines Christian concept of God is love and points out that empire as it exists is valueless in a Christian sense because it's not based on love, right? When Christianity is helping this colonial enterprise to make more money for this, their own nation building, then we cannot say Christianity is based on love. And Mrs. Moore feels that if God is love, then Christianity at this point is not based on love. When it comes to empire, Christianity can only criticize it theoretically. Okay, in practical terms, at worst, it collaborates, it works, and it helps the empire, and just can talk against it. No, they don't do anything about it. They just talk against it. And the two missionaries, old Mr. Graceford and young Mr. Thorley, cannot convince any Indian seriously of the strengths of Christianity. The only time they win converts temporarily is during the famine. So though they are evangelists and they want to convert Indians to Christianity, their talk does not win any converts. And the only converts they are able to get is during times of famine. When they promise food, people convert. That's what happens. So when asked whether Christianity is sufficiently open to all life forms, including monkeys, jackals, and bacteria, they hesitate and finally draw back. These priests, they're not able to give the right answer. So Christianity is thus shown to be insufficiently inclusive. That means they don't include everyone, so not everyone will die and go to heaven, according to the Christian concept. So it doesn't prove to be sufficient, as far as Foster was concerned. Now, I have to mention, going to talk about Islam and something about Parda. So this was begun in northern India as a response to the fact of foreign invasion. At no time was it total, in the sense that women who worked on the land, for instance, were not in Parda. Hence, Parda was always a statement that had resonance on all three counts of race, class, and gender. And Aziz's points speak of the fact that even if India wins political freedom, she will never win cultural freedom until her women are free and equal. So more than religion and everything, what is important socially, politically is for there to be gender equality also, right? So even if there is political freedom, India can never be truly free until her women are free. And until gender justice is ensured, Indian nationhood and Indian freedom are only distant dreams. So India to exist as a true nation should stop any kind of discrimination against not only marginalized people, but also marginalized gender, that is the women. Now, how does he look at Islam, okay, in the novel? Foster's response to Islam was strongly colored by his reactions against Christianity. To him, Islam seems genuinely democratic in both theory and practice, unlike Christianity. So he thinks that Islam is more democratic. He feels that there is an equality of worship and that there's no hierarchy of priests, right? So there's, like in Christianity, there is a hierarchy of priests, right? You have bishops and archbishops, common priests and bishops and archbishops. I mean, such a hierarchy of priests. So all worshippers in Islam are same. I mean, even in Hinduism, there are different kinds, levels of priests, right? All worshippers are at the same level from God, who is transcendent. This is what he understands about Islam. In the novel, Islam, while associated with beauty, is also associated specifically with the sense of elegy or the sense of passing away of an age. So, something having been lost irrevocably or irretrievably, you know. While Aziz and his friends respond to this, they're also shown to be oblivious to the fact that 100 Indias, other than their private nation, exist. So, at first, they talk about Muslim superiority, but then later, they understand that, you know, they're talking about a universe that can never be retrieved, right? They are shown to be oblivious to the fact that 100 Indias, other than their private nation, exist. So that's what happens. And Islam, however beautiful and sensitive as it is, might not be enough. And it has room for the glory of life, God as the unattainable friend, but not for its horrors. Ultimately, then Islam, like Christianity, is inadequate because it is exclusive. So not everything can be included. So there is this God himself becomes like an unattainable friend. So in that sense, you know, Islam, although definitely considered by Foster as better than, he had more affinity towards Islam than towards Christianity. Yet it's also seen as not fully inclusive. Then what about Hinduism? How does he look at it? See, Foster's initial response to Hinduism was one of confusion and alarm. A quote from his letter, "The Hindu character is almost incomprehensible to us. The more I know, the less I understand. With Mohammedans, it is different. When after the nightmare of Gokul Ashtami, I stood on the minaret of the Taj in Agra and I heard the evening call to prayer from the adjacent mosque, I knew at all events where I stood and what I heard." So Hinduism is so chaotic that at first he's completely, you know, disoriented. He doesn't know what to make of it. And he feels that with Islam, there is everything which is, you know, predefined, and it seems to make more sense to him than Hinduism. But later, you know, his responses to it change and it becomes more complex and sensitive when he understands that the chaos might perhaps be the all-inclusiveness of Hinduism. So in the other two religions, when he had found, you know, areas of exclusion, you know, here he finds there is more inclusion. But going with that inclusion is the chaos and, you know, the tumult of what he associates with Hinduism. Foster finds relief in the way of worship, which does not insist on congregation. In both the other religions, there are these insistences on congregation, whether it is in congregating at the mosque or congregating in the church. But in Hinduism, there is no insistence on congregation. So he finds relief in that because each person can worship in the way they want. That's why he finds a sense of, you know, inclusion in that. Yet, Hinduism irritates Foster, okay? Because its external manifestations frustrate a search for beauty and for meaning. So the external manifestation of Hinduism, you know, the multiple rituals and pujas and all of these things, you know, seem to really confuse him and frustrate his search for beauty and meaning. And thus he seems doomed to remain an outsider. This is more than what he can understand. So it's not likely that, you know, he will feel included in this religion also. At the same time, Foster realizes that this appears chaotic only to the outside observer. The participants see clearly a purpose and meaning in the chaos, since their faces in turn become blissfully serene. So he finds that Hindus themselves, they become very serene, although there is chaos to an outsider. So that is the way in which he approaches Hinduism. Now, Foster, while writing about Janmashtami celebrations, tries to show that there is a meaning behind what appears to be slapstick. Okay? Janmashtami celebration seems to be like fun and frolic and complete slapstick comedy. But then when he writes about it, you know, there seems to be, he feels that there seems to be some meaning behind it. And he shows that while both Christianity and Islam require the exclusion of some categories, Hinduism makes no such demand. Before it, science, history, beauty itself, which habitually require categories and entail exclusion, must fall. So even, you know, categories like science and history, all that will fall in front of such a religion where everything is included. Now, Hinduism is remarkable precisely because it triumphs over stereotypes of beauty. Yet, it raises questions as to why should it be necessary for any religion to have to triumph over science and history. So, it should coexist ideally, right? Not one triumphing over the other. So, it is a limitation for temple to depict an Aziz who, under the pressures of life in a Hindu state, gives up his scientific vocation. He retreats to Mao, gives up his scientific vocation. So this can be taken as, a limitation there, right? Where a Muslim doctor who retreats, because he cannot cope up with the life in a Hindu state, and he even gives up his scientific vocation. So surely it's not a prerequisite for Hinduism that science has to be abandoned any more than history. Both in India and Hinduism are seen as mysterious and irrational. Okay, and applying Said's paradigm, India is being shown as needing to be ruled by the organized rational West. Like we saw earlier, Said's paradigm, Said's example of what it means to be the Orient, qualities of irrationality, qualities of vulnerability, which leads to the feeling by the rational West that the East is to be ruled, to be ruled over. So therefore we can say, India and Hinduism, as seen as mysterious and irrational, lead the West to think that they can be ruled over. So A Passage to India recognizes multiculturalism, but does so within such a strong Orientalist paradigm that its representation of India is reactionary rather than radical. So Foster's presentation of India becomes more reactionary. Reactionary means something that is opposing progress, opposing reform, rather than radical. So it doesn't suggest any radical changes, rather it's reactionary in its presentation of India, according to this Orientalist paradigm. Passages from India, a symbolic use of landscape and motif in A Passage to India. So how is landscape used here? See, Adila sees what appears to be spectacular sunrise, only to find later that it has been a mirage. It's not reality. When sun actually rises, it does so without any splendor. So the splendid sunrise that she's been waiting for, it just becomes unreal. A little later, she sees what appears to be a snake. And Aziz and the villagers promote her delusion until she looks at it more closely and finds it is a tree stump. So the Indian landscape is shown to hold out a promise of exoticism it fails to keep. So everything, landscape, as Adila sees it, as the Western eye sees it, it seems to be more exotic than it really is. So what does this mean? See, presenting India to his readers without the conventional trappings of Raj fiction, that is British Raj fiction, the typical conventions of British Raj fiction, talking about nature and snakes. There's no British fiction without presenting India as an exotic land of snakes and serpents, right? Then he's confident that it can make an impact without the glorious sunrise or the mysterious snake. So stereotypical representations of India. Foster's presentation of a muddled and chaotic India is very much in keeping with the Orientalist paradigm of an irrational and therefore inferior cult. So like Said said, how the Orientalist paradigm is, right? And Foster presents India as muddled, chaotic, irrational, mysterious, right? So therefore an inferior culture to be ruled on by the West. So that's how it is presented. Then cultural presentation. See, landscapes from the world of culture suggest the circularity of human experience and the impossibility of translating it across cultures. So thus they embody the metaphysical quest of modernism, but in doing so, take the reader away from the socio-cultural realities of India. When Foster tries to present the metaphysical picture, metaphysical essence of what is India, he drifts away from the socio-cultural realities of India. That's the cultural landscape that is presented here. Then, what are the motives of sight and sound? See, motives of sight and sound together present an incoherent, irrational India, which seems in desperate need of Western clarity and control. The sounds, you know, sight and sound is something that, you know, that they cannot understand, and hence they need to control it. The Western clarity needs to control it. Stage and screen versions of the novel and the novel itself possess conclusions that evoke the notion of a passage not to but from India. A passage that is not to India actually, but from India, a journey from India. So a passage to India, it's a journey, right? And journeys are metaphorical also. Journeys need not always be a physical journey. A journey is can be a metaphorical one where one journeys into oneself. And here a journey to India becomes rather a journey from India. Because India is not something which is easily comprehensible to the Western rational mind. So with that, this novel is over. The next novel that we have to study is The Prime of Miss Brodie. Okay, The Real Sparks. So we'll do that in the next week, and after that there will be one more class where we discuss, you know, how to write essays and general stuff like that. Now in this novel, there is a film version also available. Okay. If you hunt around, I'm sure at least you can find snippets, you know. You can find snippets from YouTube and, you know, elsewhere, okay, of the film. It would be good if you watch it, because you will understand the way in which the story progresses more easily. And I'll also send you some resources on the WhatsApp group along with the, you know, PPTs that I have created. All right. So if anyone has any questions.
I'm in this Marabar episode. Marabar cave episode. Is that the case that the voice that is hidden in themselves, like, you know, both of them are female characters, like, you know, who is hearing
this
echo?
Yes. So
is it like, you know, women always have this hidden thoughts inside themselves, which is getting amplified when they are in that case?
Yes. About the unconscious. Yes. And women characters are the ones who are experiencing it.
Yes, only women are experiencing it. That is what I was wondering in this entire story.
Yes, so you could connect it with, you know, the feminine consciousness.
Okay. And especially we're talking about mandala and all that, we can find in Sri Chakra. Sri Chakra also has this mandala concept in between bindu.
Bindu, central bindu.
Yes. So all that. Because they haven't given any explanation as it why only
no they're not giving yeah so even yeah so Mrs. Moore also feels uncomfortable, you know. And also Adela does not even understand what has happened to her, you know. She only at that point she feels that she's been attacked by someone, and she assumes that it is Dr. Aziz who has attacked her, tried to rape her. But later when she goes back to Chandrapur, and after some time, she feels that she may have had some sort of, you know, hallucination or some sort of, you know, disoriented feeling. So they don't know how to explain what has happened to them.
The catharsis is kind of an episode.
Pardon?
Catharsis is kind of an episode, like, you know, wherein all your
Yes.
Deeper feelings are amplified and you're feeling, you don't know what to do. So exactly. We experience this while doing yoga.
It's like, you know, it's a symbolic representation that, you know, before that comes the mosque, section mosque, and then comes cave, then comes the temple, right? So
yes,
in between the mosque and the temple, you know, there is this divide of the cave where everything is hazy, nothing is clear cut, there is no clarity. Just like, you know, how within this diversity that we say India, there is always this gray area where, you know, none can see eye to eye, right? Which is why we stood divided, right, when the British left.
Okay, ma'am.
So it's also on that count, you can say.
Okay, ma'am.
I'll send you some more material on the group, okay?
Sure, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, then. All right. So, shall I call it a day? It's almost 1 hour past our ending time.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am,
no attendance today. They haven't circulated any attendance sheet to us.
Pardon? I can't hear you clearly.
Ma'am, they haven't circulated any attendance sheet to us.
Really? No attendance sheet today? It was sent earlier. Was it sent earlier? Can someone resend it, please? Yeah, I see it here. Yeah. Let me copy it and send it.
Thank you.
Ma'am?
Yeah?
Ma'am, just another doubt. Why did Mrs. Moore think the other way? Why did she feel that Aziz was innocent?
Because she's a person who understands, you know, what is India very instinctively, very intuitively. The minute she meets Dr. Aziz, right, they strike up a friendship which lasts to the end, actually, you know. And when Ronnie asks her whether she can give any evidence against Dr. Aziz, she says, I have no evidence to give, because she believes in his innocence. She doesn't have any evidence to give. And that's why he sends her away from Chandrapur back to England. So we talked about the silencing of Mrs. Moore's voice, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So maybe it's the emotional connect that she has with this
exactly.
Mr. Aziz.
Yes, okay. That is an immediate connection. The minute Aziz sees her at the mosque, when she keeps her footwear outside, he understands that she's, an English woman, not like the others. She's different from the others. She has a deeper sense of, understanding of what is...
of this chaos. Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
All right. Welcome. So, see you next week then. Bye-bye.
Thank you, ma'am.
You're welcome. Bye-bye.